Welcome back, my friends. I just saw Kurzgesagt posted a video like 13 hours ago, so let's check it out. Before we get into it, I'm doing this daily dance newsletter every day. It's completely free, just breaking down the science. It's been going out every day, so you should check your spam, you know, your junk folders. Could be in there. It's going well, though. I think we just hit 1,000 people in it, so that's awesome, and I'm loving writing them. So come check it out. Completely free. Kel's still coming along. Tell you more about that soon. And what else is there to say? I think that's about it. I hope you're all doing well. Let's get into the video. Is civilization on the brink of collapse and could we recover? And the reason why we're doing this video, you know, you might be like, what does this have to do with physics? Well, our world, society, is completely and utterly dependent on science and technology. And all of the most fundamental of that stuff comes from our understanding of physics. And, you know, if you go way back, everything we've done in physics has, you know, essentially led to where we are today. And so you can bet the way out of this is, you know, discoveries and, you know, lots of stuff in physics, whether it's from, you know, engineers manipulating things we know or whoever, this is how we're going to recover. So I thought we could maybe talk about that towards the end of the video. And, you know, there are things like nuclear war and stuff, things like that, which, again, thanks to physics.
At its height, the Roman Empire was home to about 30% of the world's population, and in many ways, it was the pinnacle of human advancement. Its citizens enjoyed the benefits of central heating, concrete, double glazing, banking, international trade, and upward social mobility. Rome became the first city in history with 1 million inhabitants, and was a center of technological, legal, and economic progress. An empire impossible to topple, stable and rich and powerful. Until it wasn't anymore. First slowly, then suddenly, the most powerful civilization on Earth collapsed. By civilization, we mean a complex...
This background theme is reminding me of something, but I can't pick it. It's something recent as well.
...society, where labor is specialized and social classes emerge, and which is ruled by institutions. Civilizations share a dominant mutual language and culture, and domesticate plants and animals to feed and sustain large cities, where they often construct impressive monuments. Civilization lets us become efficient on large scales, collect vast amounts of knowledge, and put human ingenuity and the natural resources of the world to work. Without civilization, most people would never have been born. Which makes it a bit concerning that collapse is the rule, not the exception. Virtually all civilizations end, on average, after 340 years. That's collapse is rarely nice for individuals. Their shared cultural identity is shattered as institutions lose the power to organize people. Knowledge is lost, living standards fall, violence increases, and often the population declines. The civilization either completely disappears, is absorbed by stronger neighbors, or something new emerges, sometimes with more primitive technology than before. If this is how it's been over the ages, what about us today?
Have you guys ever seen that MIT study that tried to predict the collapse of civilization? There was a study in 1972, and it basically predicted society, global civilization would collapse by 2040. And guess what? We're right on track. It was fairly recent as well. They did some more news on it. And the author was saying, yeah, like, the computer simulations are still on track. So, but this, she was trying to be optimistic by saying, you know, like, there's ways we can stop this still. And there's new things, you know, that we didn't know about in 1972. So, you know, obviously nothing is set in stone, and the simulation is extremely simplistic. You know, any simulation of complex phenomena is going to have to be some kind of, you know, simplification. We need to kind of act now if we want to avoid these costs that are a lot larger than what we're currently seeing.
Just as Europeans forgot how to build indoor plumbing and make cement, will we lose our industrial technology? And with that, our greatest achievements, from $1 pizza to smartphones or laser eye surgery, will all this go away too? Today, our cities stretch for thousands of square kilometers. We travel the skies. Our communication is instant. Industrial agriculture with engineered high-yield plants efficient machinery and high-potency fertilizer feeds billions of people. Modern medicine gives us the longest lifespan we've ever had, while industrial technology gives us an unprecedented level of comfort and abundance, even though we haven't yet learned to attain them without destroying our ecosphere. There are arguably still different civilizations around today that compete and coexist with each other, but together they also form a singular global civilization. But this modern globalized civilization is even more vulnerable in some ways than past empires because we are much more deeply interconnected. A collapse of the industrialized world literally means that the majority of people alive today would perish, since without industrial agriculture, we would no longer be able to feed them. And there's an even greater risk. What if a collapse was so deeply destructive that we were unable to re-industrialize again? What if it ruined our chances of enjoying a flourishing future as a multi-planetary...
Don't get too scared, I have a simple solution to this problem.
...species. A global civilizational collapse could be an existential catastrophe, something that ruins not just the lives of everyone alive today, but all the future generations that could have come into being. All the knowledge we might have discovered, the art we might have created, the joys we might have experienced would be lost. So, how likely is all of this?
I remember when I was younger and Stephen Hawking was saying, you know, come on guys, we got to, you know, get a move on. We've got about 1,000 years left, probably, right? And I remember thinking, where is he pulling this number from, 1,000? I was, at the time, I was like, it's more like 100. Just, you know, if you know some of the numbers of these things, like the finite resources we have, it's closer to 100, Stephen. Like, what is he talking about? So I figured, you know, either I was wrong or he's just trying to be optimistic. And then just before he died, which was, you know, tragedy, he announced, you know, he knew he was passing on. And he announced that, okay, I lied. We actually have more like 100 years. You know, I was being optimistic. I wanted to, you know, not scare people, but we need to get a move on. You guys need to get your shit together. And so I was like, ah, you know, there it is. There's the truth. So, yeah. You don't trust, take my word for it. Take Stephen Hawking.
Let's start with some good news. While civilization collapses have happened regularly, none have ever derailed the course of global civilization. Rome collapsed, but the Aksumite
I don't think that is really that good news, you know? That's not exactly relevant to the current civilization.
Empire, or the Teotihuacans, and of course the Byzantine Empire, carried on. What about sudden population crashes? So far, we've not seen a catastrophe that has killed much more than 10% of the global population. No pandemic, no natural disaster.
In our time, you know, you've probably heard of mass extinction events. You know, there's several of them where a lot of the life on Earth just completely disappeared.
No war. The last clear example of a rapid global population decrease was the Black Death, a pandemic of the bubonic plague in the 14th century that spread across the Middle East and Europe and killed a third of all Europeans and about one-tenth of the global population.
Random thing I remember, I've always wanted to go to Madagascar, and I saw the other year, maybe a while back now, that the Black Death, the plague, is you know, still around in Madagascar. And there's a massive problem there because cultural tradition is after someone dies there, the whole village apparently gets together and, like, you know, has to touch the body and carries them. I think it's to the funeral or something. After they bury the body, they then dig it up and then they all have to touch it and lift it up. And that's kind of, you know, a problem when the Black Death is going around. So, you know, that's kind of how it spreads. And so I believe the government there actually tried to ban a local, like, tradition, which has been around for a long time there, which is, you know, pretty crazy, and no one's really listening to it. So I haven't actually checked up on this situation. Always wanted to go to Madagascar and see those little lemurs. But yeah, I just thought that was an interesting thing to bring
population.
Up.
If any event was going to cause the collapse of civilization, that should have been it. But even the Black Death demonstrates humanity's resilience more than its fragility. While the old societies were massively disrupted in the short term, the intense loss of human lives and suffering did little to negatively impact European economic and technological development in the long run. Population size recovered within 2 centuries, and just 2 centuries later, the Industrial Revolution began. History is full of incredible recoveries from horrible tragedies. Take the atomic bombing of Hiroshima during World War II. 140,000 people were killed, and 90% of the city was at least partially incinerated or reduced to rubble. But against all odds, they made a remarkable recovery. Hiroshima's population recovered within a decade, and today, it's a thriving city of 1.2 million people. None of this made these horrible events any less horrible for those who lived through them. But for us as a species, these signs of resilience are good news. Why recovery is likely, even in the worst case. One thing that's different from historic...
That's extremely untrue, because worst case would be some kind of natural disaster that shifts the natural balance that the Earth, our ecosystems, and just global climate is in, because that renders the planet something like Venus or Mars. That's not good. There's no recovery from there. Maybe, I don't know, like...
Historic collapses is that humanity now has unprecedented destructive power. Today's nuclear arsenals are so powerful that all-out global war could cause a nuclear winter and billions of deaths.
There's so many people in, I just guess, outside of, the hard sciences, particularly physics. Maybe, I'm looking at the historians in particular who like to say, you can judge what's going to happen in the future based on what's happened in the past. And look, that's been true for all of human history, but I think we're actually at an impasse here where that doesn't apply anymore. The future is currently, we can't tell what's going to happen because the power we now yield and all of this technology has completely changed not just our world, but us. Are we even human anymore? Like Elon likes to say, we're actually already like half cybernetic. We're like half cyborg with iPhones. We're attached to it all day, every day. We're very different creatures. Whilst we're the same as, 50,000 years ago, our brains haven't seemed to really have changed. Just, over a lifetime, what results, from this experience, these experiences is something kind of different. I'm not sure the same rules apply. I think we're playing a different game. And we can't look to the past anymore. I think with all this technology, which is actually propping up civilization, the only way to predict the future is to look into science and nature and where it could lead, not into the past anymore. That'll piss a lot of people off, I'm sure. So, come at me in the comments. But what I'm getting at is we're approaching some great filters, it kind of looks like, some of which we've never, had to face before. So I'm not sure... The past is a good indicator. Maybe if we had simulations of civilizations arising, technological ones, we could use what happens there. But with what's happened in the past humanity, not sure it is the same anymore. Different game.
Our knowledge of our own biology and how to manipulate it is getting so advanced that it's becoming possible to engineer viruses as contagious as the coronavirus and as deadly as Ebola. Increasingly, the risk of global pandemics is much higher than in the past. So we may cause a collapse ourselves, and it might be much worse than the things nature has thrown at us so far.
No way.
But if, say, 99% of the population died, would global civilization collapse?
Nature's imagination far exceeds our own, my friend.
Forever. Could we recover from such a tragedy? We have some reasons to be optimistic.
For sure.
Let's start with food. There are 1 billion agricultural workers today, so even if the global population fell to just 80 million, it's virtually guaranteed that many survivors would know how to produce food. And we don't need to start at square one, because we could still use modern high-yield crops. Maize is 10 times bigger than its wild ancestor. Ancient tomatoes were the size of today's peas. After agriculture, the next step towards recovery would be rebuilding industrial capacity, like power grids and automated manufacturing. A huge problem is that our economies of scale make it impossible to just pick up where we left off. Many of our high-tech industries are only functional because of huge demand and intensely interconnected supply chains across different continents. Even if our infrastructure were left unharmed, we would make huge steps backwards technologically. But then again, we are thinking in larger timeframes. Industrialization originally happened 12,000 years after the agricultural revolution. So if we need to start over after a massive collapse, it shouldn't be that hard to reindustrialize, at least on evolutionary timescales. There's a hitch, though. The Industrial Revolution was fueled, literally, by burning easily accessible coal, and we are still very much reliant on it. If we use it all up today, aside from making rapid climate change much worse, we could hinder our ability to recover from a huge crisis. So we should stop using easy-to-access coal, so it can serve as a civilization insurance in case something bad happens.
Good idea.
Another thing that makes recovery likely is that we'd probably have most of the information we need to rebuild civilization. We would certainly lose a lot of crucial institutional knowledge, especially on hard drives that nobody could read or operate anymore. But a lot of the technological, scientific, and cultural knowledge stored in the world's 2.6 million libraries would survive the catastrophe. The post-collapse survivors would know what used to be possible, and they could reverse engineer some...
I mean, most papers aren't printed these days anymore, so... Up to a point, I'm not sure how long ago, you know, we switched.
...tools and machines they'd find. In conclusion, despite the bleak prospect of catastrophic threats, natural or created by ourselves, there is reason for optimism. Humankind is remarkably resilient, and even in the case of a global civilizational collapse, it seems likely that we would be able to recover, even if many people were to perish or suffer immense hardship, even if we lost cultural and technological achievements in the process. But given the stakes, the risks are still unnervingly high. Nuclear war and dangerous pandemics threaten the amazing global civilization we have built. Humanity is like a teenager, speeding around blind corners, drunk without a seatbelt. The good news is that it's still early enough to prepare for and to mitigate these risks. We just need to actually do it.
Okay, so my simple solution. You want to hear it? You ready? We just need more physicists and engineers. That's all we need. We're going to face problems in the future. Big, major technological problems that will only be overcome with science and technology. How are we going to overcome them if we only have two engineers or physicists in the world who can actually help with this problem? So yeah, get out there, become an engineer or a physicist, help save the world.